And we are back on WGN-TV Political Report. On Tuesday, voters in Chicago's northern and southwestern suburbs will be tasked with picking two state Supreme Court justices. Now, last year, lawmakers drew new boundaries for the state Supreme Court districts for the first time in nearly 60 years. The candidates run under the banner of a political party, but once elected, they're expected to be fair and impartial. Right now, Democrats hold a slim 4-3 majority in the Northern 2nd District. Circuit Court Judge Democrat Elizabeth Rochford is battling Republican Attorney Mark Curran for that seat. And to the south and west of the city, sitting Justice and Republican Michael Burke is facing a challenge in a new district from Democratic Appellate Court Judge Mary O'Brien. Both sides say the outcome of the two contests could shape Illinois' future for the next decade and even beyond.
This election will determine whether Illinois continues down this road to economic ruin, to ever-increasing crime, or whether we have a chance for a new beginning.
My opponent has never been a judge. My opponent has been found not recommended by every bar association, and he has an extreme political agenda that he'd like to take to the courts.
Millions of dollars have been poured into the race on both sides from labor groups, conservative PACs, and more, with major funding coming from right-wing mega donor Dick Uihlein and Democratic Governor J.B. Pritzker himself. Well, joining me this morning is Tim Tomasik. He's president of the Chicago Bar Association, past chair of the organization's Judicial Evaluation Committee. Tim, thanks for coming in. Appreciate it.
Good morning, Paul. Happy to be here.
So the goal, and you've written about this, is to keep politics out of the court system, and yet we know everybody, all the candidates' political affiliations. Isn't that a challenge to impartiality?
You know, it may seem so on its face, and it's really a good question for Election Day. But the bottom line is that our Constitution, which is ratified in 1970, requires candidates for judicial office, Supreme Court, Appellate Court, or the Circuit Court to file just like any other candidate and affiliate with the party.
So getting slated to be one of those candidates, obviously we know how it happens. They don't pull you off the street to do it. You know people. You've been involved with people. So it's not coming from obscurity. So once again, how do these candidates maintain impartiality when clearly they've probably been put there by political forces?
That's a very good question. 2 points about slating. Number one, in order to get slated, the party usually requires that that candidate be found qualified or highly qualified by the Chicago Bar Association. Further, I would point out that over the years, slating doesn't go as far as it used to. Just in this last election, there were two slated candidates for the Appellate Court who lost, and I believe there were 5 slated candidates who also lost in the last 2 cycles. So while it has some meaning, I do not think that it in any way it determines an election. Also, I would point out, I just voted last week. I voted for 30 judges for the Circuit Court and the Appellate Court. They all ran on the Democratic Party. There was no Republican opposition, and I've watched this for 30 years. In Cook County, there are many moderate Republicans and Republicans that run as a Democrat. So I'm not so sure the party affiliation really tells you where they lean.
Ah, interesting. Now, 3 of the 4 Supreme Court nominees, as I've mentioned, Democrats Elizabeth Rochford, Mary Kay O'Brien, and by the way, Republican Michael Burke. They've all been rated by the various bar associations as qualified or highly qualified or recommended. Mark Curran is the only one who has not been, but actually there's one reason for that, which is he didn't show to be evaluated. Talk to me about that as a strategy.
Sure. You know, having been involved in judicial evaluations since 1998, when a candidate does not present or fill out the paperwork or questionnaire and appear before their peers and be questioned about their career, that's a true tell to us and to the voters, because that candidate likely knows they're going to be found not qualified. So they'd rather be in a position where they can say, I was found not qualified, but I did not appear. But also, you know, think of the candidates we criticize for not appearing for a debate. I think this is one step worse. Why not appear before your peers, be asked about your experience, be asked about how your adversaries feel about you, what judges have said about your career as a lawyer. So that's why that particular candidate has not been found qualified or recommended. And it happens often, usually with circuit court candidates as well.
And just one other current question. He doesn't currently sit on a bench, so I'm sort of curious. Could he have been found unqualified had he shown up for the evaluations just because he's not currently a judge?
There is a possibility that he could have been found qualified. I think when you're talking about something like the Supreme Court, serving as a judge at the circuit court level or appellate court level is important, but certainly it is not out of question that the candidate could have been found qualified.
Let's talk a little bit about money in these campaigns. You've just written an article about this, which intrigued me. Look, the roof came off of all of this with the Citizens United case from the Supreme Court a couple of years. We'll leave that aside. But talk to me right now about the power of money and even dark money that enters these races.
It really is disturbing, Paul. It's at a record high right now, the money that's poured into elections. I think the Brennan Center for Justice determined that the last cycle was a record amount of money, $97 million nationwide. Just here in the state of Illinois, there was a record amount spent in the Justice Kilbride retention election. So it has not a tendency, it absolutely distracts and provides voters with misinformation, because the real issues the Supreme Court are dealing with, which have to do with safety, school systems, pensions, liberty, habeas corpus.
Not what the ads are about.
That's not what the ads are about, right? They want to talk about one thing or two things, abortion and guns. And, you know, there's been one gun case heard by the Supreme Court. Is it possible there could or might be a case heard on abortion? Sure. But it's really not the primary focus of our own.
So a lot of this money gets ads on the air. Are these ads therefore misleading because it creates an importance about something that isn't going to be a focus of the court?
I do think that's an accurate statement. It's a bunch of noise, Paul, because all the chatter and talk is about abortion. All the chatter and talk is about pro-choice, pro-life. Is that an important issue? Sure, but there are many, many more important issues that our justices deal with. Think about it. Criminal cases, products liability cases, breach of contract cases, landlord-tenant matters, and of course, so many criminal matters that the court hears. So while it's an important issue, it by no means should determine anyone's vote.
And indeed, judges are somebody that many people who say, well, I don't impact, you know, what somebody at a high level is going to be, but at a judge level, they might find themselves in a courtroom. Finally, what advice do you have for our viewers who are watching and saying, I don't know these judges, I don't know who they are, how am I supposed to prepare?
I recommend strongly that all voters go to the Chicago Bar Association website, take a look at our Judicial Voters Guide, where all our recommendations are, because we spend thousands of hours investigating these candidates, looking into their backgrounds, talking to their adversaries, talking to judges. We have confidential reports, a hearing where they actually answer questions. And so our recommendations are the true product of a very thorough process. I'd also point this out. If you were going to go buy an SUV or minivan for your kids and your spouse, would you just read a blog, or would you go to the National Highway Safety Institute and look at the actual crash data on all the different vehicles? And I think when you look at the CBA's ratings and other bar associations, that's what you find.
Yeah, I won't give you my answer to that question. Thank you, Tomasik. Good to see you. President of the Chicago Bar Association.
Thanks for having me, Paul.
And still to come on WGN-TV Political Report, Democrats fight to hang on to power in Washington. Can they stop a red wave from hitting Congress on Tuesday? We're going to talk about it when we come back. Stay with us.